prepare to hear the word of the Lord, we are going to sing a prayer, and the words begin with, "Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word." So as we sing, may our hearts pray and get ready to hear what the word of the Lord is going to speak to us today. Gideon, he's like, "Oh, is that the guy that marched around the city?" Not that guy. And we talked about it. Oh yeah. He's the one that, and what we're going to talk about today. So he's just one of those classic stories that is worth repeating. Now the backstory is, the Israelites were slaves in Egypt for 400 years, and the Lord sent Moses to deliver them out of Egypt into the promised land, except the Israelites were disobedient, and they had temper tantrums, and they rebelled against God, and so God allowed for them to wander in the desert for 40 years while they were building relationship with him, growing to trust him, getting to know who God is, what he's like, what can he be counted on for, because they have a 400-year history of being slaves, and so they worked that out. And then comes Joshua after Moses, and he leads the people across the Jordan River into the Promised Land. Now, the Israelite people who are in the Promised Land, living where God has delivered them, don't have a king. Like every other nation, everybody has kings, but the Israelites don't, because the Lord is their leader. The Lord is their king. They're different. They're going to be different. But they did have judges. So Gideon happens in the time of judges, judges who mediate and direct and guide and give wisdom. And there was a judge named Deborah, and she ruled for 40 years, and under her leadership, I shouldn't say the word ruled because God was their ruler, their leader, but under Deborah's leadership, the nation of Israel had peace for 40 years, and then Deborah died. And then for the following 7 years, the Israelites went sideways again. They worshipped other gods, they forgot about the Lord and his law, they just went completely astray. And God gave them into the hands of Midian, and it was terrible because the Midianites oppressed them. And in the phrase that comes up often in these chapters is the Midianites, the Amalekites, and the other eastern peoples. They were so oppressive to the Israelites. They would come in and they would invade and they would trample their crops and kill their animals. And the Israelites ended up having to move into the mountains, into the crevices, into the rocks to escape this oppression by these people that could no more be counted than the sands, the grains of sand. There were so many, they referenced the camels, there were so many camels they could no more be counted than the grains of sand. So many people oppressing them. And then verse 10 says, verse 6. Midianites so impoverished the Israelites that they cried out to the Lord for help. Enter Gideon. Gideon's a guy. He's an Israelite. When we begin our story, he is threshing wheat with a wine press. And I'm not going to go into all the science of that, but that's a very difficult thing to do. And they're doing it that way because they're trying to hide from the Midianites that they have food. Because if they have food, the Midianites will steal it. So the way they do that is they take the wheat, which, like I said, I can't even begin to understand this whole process, but they're using a wine press to thresh their wheat, which is tedious and challenging. So this is where Gideon is. Gideon's a guy. He's an Israelite guy. Hear the word of the Lord from Judges 6 and 7, beginning at verse 12. If you want to follow along, I will kind of try to guide us and state the verse numbers. But we'll start at verse 12. The angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon. He said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." Gideon replied, "Pardon me, my Lord, but if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all the wonders that our ancestors told us about when they said, 'Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt?' But now, the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hands of Midian." The Lord returned to him and said, "Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you?" Gideon replied, "Pardon me, my Lord, but how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family." The Lord answered, "I will be with you." And then Gideon has a conversation with this presence, this angel of the Lord, the Lord himself, and says, "Yeah, I'm going to need some evidence. I'm going to need some proof that you're really the Lord. I'm going to go make an offering, and you wait here." And the Lord says, "Okay." So Gideon goes, and he prepares his offering, and he brings it back, and the Lord consumes it. And Gideon's like, "Whoa, this is indeed the Lord." So he's taking steps to recognize, okay, the Lord is in this. Verse 34. Then the Spirit of the Lord came on Gideon, and he blew a trumpet. And when Gideon, this dude, wine press dude, when he blows the trumpet, 32,000 soldiers come. Okay. So it appears that this is the Lord, and he's working, and he's in this, but Gideon's a little like, okay, I need some more evidence. I need something on good faith. If you give me another sign, tonight I'm going to lay a fleece on the ground, and if in the morning the fleece is wet and the ground is dry, then I know that in fact you're going to do what you say you're going to do, and I'm going to deliver, you're going to deliver the Israelite people. And so the Lord says, okay. Wakes up in the morning, the fleece is wet, the ground is dry. Gideon says, "I just need one more bit of evidence. Just
give me something. One more thing. I just need to know for sure that you're really in this spot. I really, really need to know that you're going to do what you say you're going to do. So tonight, I'll put that fleece out, and then the fleece will be dry and the ground will be wet. And the Lord says, okay. And wakes up, fleece is dry, ground is wet. Chapter 7, verse 2. The Lord said to Gideon, you have too many men. I cannot deliver Midian into their hands. There are 32,000 sets of hands. Or Israel will boast against me. My own strength has saved me. Now announce to my army, anyone who trembles with fear may turn back and leave Mount Gilead. So 22,000 men left while 10,000 remained. But the Lord said to Gideon, no, there are still too many men. Verse 5. So Gideon took the men down to the water. Verse 6. 300 of them drank from cupped hands, lapping the dog like dogs. All the rest got down on their knees to drink. The Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men that lapped, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hand. And then, verse 9, during the night, the Lord said to Gideon, verse 10, if you are afraid to attack, go down to the camp with your servant Purah and listen to what they are saying. Verse 13, Gideon arrived just as a man was telling a friend his dream. I have a dream, he says. A round loaf of barley bread came tumbling into the Midianite camp. It struck the tent with such force that the tent overturned and collapsed. And his friend responded, this can be nothing other than the sword of Gideon, son of Joash, the Israelite. God has given the Midianites, the whole camp, into his hands. When Gideon heard the dream and its interpretation, he bowed down and worshiped. He returned to the camp of Israel and called out, get up! The Lord has given the Midianite camp into your hands. And so he did. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So, Jim Quist, have been leading this spiritual gifts class, which has been so much fun. Right, Jim? So much fun. But don't worry if you're thinking right now, oh no, I missed the spiritual gifts class. You have not missed it all. We have one more week next week. You have a chance to come yet. You're all invited. So in this spiritual gifts class, this is one of the principles that we have talked about. Spiritual gifts are from God, and they are through us for the church and for God's glory. And so we talk about how we can do more through the power of the Holy Spirit than we can do with our God-given natural talents. Now, you all are talented, you have abilities, you have gifts, you can do things, and we do things because God created people, he invented us, and he's amazing, and so we're amazing because we image him, and he does all kinds of things through us. I love that about the human condition. My kids, middle school, a lot of educators will look at kids and find their weaknesses, and then shore up their weaknesses so they can be balanced in all areas. My kids, middle school, would search out the strengths of students, even maybe the hidden strengths, these hidden talents that students don't necessarily even realize that they have. And they would put them in these elective classes rather than to strengthen their weaknesses. They would put them in these elective classes to strengthen their strengths so they could grow in their gifts and in their talents and their abilities and discover new things about who they are. And I always thought that was so creative. To approach education that way, to go after the strengths. So you have strengths. But God can do more in us and through us by the power of the Holy Spirit than he can do just on our own. and our own given natural abilities. And the story of Gideon demonstrates this well. So, to summarize, the Lord initiates contact, and he says to Gideon, "The Lord is with you, quote, mighty warrior." Now, we think, if a lot of you raise your hands, and you probably think of Gideon as a warrior. Well, we think of Gideon as a warrior because of the rest of the story. But this is pre-story, and the Lord gives Gideon this new identity, mighty warrior. And Gideon responds, well, no offense, but is this the best you've got? You're with us? Have you looked outside? What's going on? We've been oppressed for 7 years, and we're like hiding in crevices and secretly making our food because these Midianites and Amalekites and all the other eastern peoples are so horrible. If you're with us, we got a problem because this isn't going so well. And the Lord, he doesn't even respond. He doesn't defend himself. He doesn't explain himself. He listens to Gideon's complaint. He doesn't shame him, or he just receives it. And the Lord says, go. Go and save Israel. You're going to be the one to deliver your people. And Gideon is a little bit, you know, he's a little feisty. And he's like, oh, really? Well, how's that going to happen? Because, like, I'm a nobody. I'm, like, a nobody in my little family, in this little clan. Like, yeah, how's that going to work? And once again, the Lord doesn't explain, oh, I have a whole plan, and it's going to work out like this, and don't worry, Gideon. He doesn't entertain any of that. He listens to Gideon. He gives Gideon his space to be frustrated and wonder and be a little anxious about what's going on. And the Lord says, I will be with you. Gideon says, really? Prove it. If that's true, and what you're saying is true, and you're the Lord, and you say you're going to be with me, prove that you are the Lord. And Gideon is bold to say this to this angel of the Lord, or the presence of the Lord. And he's in the scripture passage, if you were following along, you might have noticed that the Lord spoke, all capital, L-O-R-D, and Gideon replies, pardon me, my Lord, which is just a respectful term for any person. So he's not yet acknowledging that this is the Lord. Receive my offering. Wait here, give the offering. Gideon does that, and it's consumed, and this sacrifice is accepted. And then the Spirit of the Lord comes on Gideon. He blows his horn, and 32,000 people come. Whoa. Okay. So clearly, this is the Lord. Clearly, the Lord is in this. Gideon is acknowledging that detail. But how are we to know that you are actually going to deliver us? Because this could be a disaster. We could just go in there and get annihilated. And so he does the fleece thing, lay out a fleece. If you've ever heard that phrase before, lay out a fleece or put out a fleece before the Lord. This is the passage where that cliche that we use comes from. Put out a fleece, make your decision, decide. So he does the fleece thing, and the Lord just honors him and gives him what he needs in that. And then the Lord tells him, you have too many men. You have 32,000 men. That's 31,700 too many. Because if you go and fight, then everybody will say, oh yeah, awesome Gideon and his awesome army defeated those thugs. Rock on. Yeah, good job. And the Lord says, people will miss the fact that I, the Lord their God, am advocating for them and am fighting for them, and I'm going after them to deliver them from this oppression. If you go in your own strength like this, people will be unfazed by that. I want my people to know that I am in the trenches with them, fighting for them, that I love them, and I want to deliver them. So we have to change the dynamic a bit so people can have the vision that they need in order to see the truth of the matter. Meanwhile, the Midianites and the Amalekites and the eastern peoples are thick as locusts, 7:12 says. Their camels could no more be counted than the sand on the seashore. And the Lord acknowledges that Gideon is paying attention now. Now we're down to 300. The Lord reduces to 300. And so you've got 300 against zillions. And the Lord has Gideon's number. And he says, Gideon, are you still afraid? I got you. You and your servant, go down to the camp. Just the two of you. Sneak down there. Listen to what they're saying. And so they do. And they hear this dream. And they learn that the Midianites are terrified because God is surely going to destroy them. And Gideon's going to be the one. And so Gideon responds. He responds in worship. He bows down and he worships and he tells the Israelite camp, this is a done deal. God has our back. After all of those assurances and reassurances and evidences and reassurances and evidences and reassurances, finally Gideon says, I'm in. God's got us. Let's roll. And that's exactly what happens. It's fascinating. Go read about it. They have a creative attack strategy. They divide into three groups of 100, and it's really creative. And the Lord is on their side. And they are successful. So going back to this quote, spiritual gifts are from God, through us, for the church, and for God's glory. We see this play out beautifully in the story of Gideon. That the Holy Spirit comes upon Gideon, the Holy Spirit from God, and works through Gideon for the Israelite people, for the sake of the Israelite people. Not for Gideon's sake, not to make him into something, but for the sake of his people. God is saving his people. So Holy Spirit from God through Gideon for the sake of the Israelite people, the kingdom, and for his glory. And we just saw how the response is that Gideon bowed down and worshiped. He acknowledged, this is the Lord. Through a really long and crooked road, Gideon got there. This is the Lord who is doing this. And that's how the story plays out. Well, this might seem dramatic and miraculous and amazing, and it's one of those Old Testament Bible school Bible stories. But this is who God is. This is who he is, and this is how he operates on a daily basis in your life, in my life. And part of growing into a disciple of Christ, a faithful, mature disciple of Christ, is learning to be able to see where God is at work and be able to recognize his hand in our lives and where he's moving so we don't miss it. 10 years ago, right now, May, 10 years ago, the Lord, through a dramatic and clear and shocking way, made it clear to me that he was calling me to be a minister of the word, beginning studies at Calvin Seminary this fall. So fall 2008. Minister of the word, Calvin Seminary this fall. Now, many of you, know a lot of my backstory, or some of my backstory, so you won't be surprised to know that I was a bit shocked and surprised and no offense, but what are you thinking, God? I am not seminary material, and this seems like a crazy idea. No, I am not willing to turn my life upside down and do something that is going to make me look completely foolish because I am, it's just going to, yeah, no, I'm not doing that. There was so much anxiety, it was just overwhelming. No one ever told me, well, you should go to seminary. I mean, that's like, I think it's in church order. We're supposed to encourage people, we're supposed to tell people that we see and identify gifts in, you should go to seminary. We thought of going to seminary, like, this is what we're supposed to do. No one ever said that to me. I didn't grow up in the church. I have quite a history, and I just, I'm not doing that. And the Lord was so patient with me. He said, watch, trust me, be amazed. You're gonna be amazed, just trust me. And so I went for lots of walks. We live out in the woods, I have a border collie, I took Shep on lots of walks, and I had conversations with God over this crazy idea of going to seminary. So I started throwing out fleeces. Fleece one, time. God, I don't have time. I don't have time to go to seminary. I am involved in all these other volunteer activities. I don't even have time to get dinner on the table. How am I supposed to just go add on another graduate degree in the midst of raising my 3-year-old, 6-year-old, and 9-year-old? Yeah, if you want me to go to seminary, you're gonna have to create a whole lot of extra time in my life because it's not happening now. Fleece two, money. Lord, if you want me to go to seminary, you're gonna have to come up with the money because seminary is expensive. And we don't have the money to spend thousands of dollars on a fourth Christian education bill. So, you know, you're just, if you want that to happen, you're going to have to do something. Watch. Trust me. Be amazed. Each time I would come back to God with a reason, a good reason why I would not go to seminary. His response was the same. Watch. Trust me. Be amazed. Third fleece, my marriage. If you want me to go to seminary, my marriage has to be rock solid 100%. Because everybody knows that Satan is the enemy of marriage, and people who go to seminary, their marriages take a hit. If you want me to go to seminary, then my marriage has to be solid. Watch. Trust me. Be amazed, God would say. So that was May and June. In July, I finally applied for seminary. And in August, I took my first class. And all hell broke loose. My church, the church where we had gone for 15 years, it was a dramatic event that I had entered seminary and that the leadership was supporting me and spurring me on. We ended up having to leave our church. Dramatic, horrible, terrible, painful. Please, too, money. I said we needed the money. This is 2008. Some of you know that my husband is a home designer, builder, contractor. What happened in 2008? The market crashed. And while Chris always kept working, always, because working people get work, we went for 11 months without a paycheck. From full-time income to zero income. Zero. No income. Really? Really, Lord? This is what you got going on? Fleece three. Our marriage took a serious hit. It was a dark time when I entered seminary. My kids still remember coming up from the basement, 3, 6, and 9, and Chris and I arguing, and me taking a frying pan, throwing it on the ground. Now, the response was, They thought that was hysterical because they couldn't imagine that mom did something so naughty. Because they would get in so much trouble for that, and I did this, and they still bring it up. All of that is to say, it was bad. And yet, as it turned out, Gideon's reduce, get rid of those men, because if you just do this in your own strength, then it's just going to be like, oh, how cool are you? God was saying, I need to change the circumstances so that when you travel through this journey, people will see me. We had to leave our church, and that was dramatic, but what was my fleece? Do you remember the fleece won? Time. Suddenly, I had all of my time to devote to my education. And the Lord brought us to another church that was amazing, and it taught us so much about evangelism and outreach and being a church that allows people to come as you are, and in so many ways prepared me for Calvary Church, for our DNA here. I mean, just amazing. The money thing. We went for months and months and months and months without money. And it's like the God was saying, yeah, but see, if you just figure this out, then you'll just be very good financial planners or something, which we certainly weren't. And I got scholarships, loads of scholarships to pay for my education. And I also had the opportunity to take loans, educational loans, which I didn't need because my education was paid for. But now we had grocery money. So we could raise our family on our seminary loans and go grocery shopping and pay the electric bill and the gas bill or all the things that people need to pay when they have a house. God provided seminary in order to get us through the housing crash. So creative. So it's just amazing to me. It's just amazing to me. I don't even know how it would have all worked out if I hadn't been in seminary and had the access to the student loans. It's amazing. And as for our marriage, it was hard. Those years were hard, and we worked it out. But now, Chris and I will be celebrating our 25th anniversary in July. And our family is a delight to me, to our hearts. And I wouldn't go back. I wouldn't change it. So back to this slide. The Holy Spirit, by the power of the Holy Spirit, with gifts from God, working through me in the church and for His glory. Who I am today and the opportunities and the invitations that He puts in front of me today for the church and His glory came out of all of this process, and I wouldn't go back. It was really hard, but I wouldn't go back, and I wouldn't undo it, because at one point I even said, if I don't even get a job, this 5 years of seminary, if I don't even get a job, it will have been worth it for the way God has transformed our family and grown our faith. And Chris would always say, yeah, but you're going to get a job. Seminary leads to money. So... And I did. I did get a job. So my question to you today is, what is God inviting you into that you're holding back and resisting maybe? What is God perhaps inviting you to take steps in a direction that you're just not so sure? Are you in this, God? Do you have my back? How can I trust you? I had a friend who never wanted to completely surrender his life to the Lord and ask the Lord what he wanted to do in his life because he was terrified that God was going to make him be a missionary in Africa, and he did not want to go to Africa. So he just didn't go there. He would not go there. I'm terrified what God will say if I ask him what to do, so I'm not going to ask him. Fast forward a few years, and when he finally did get to a place where he was open to listening to what the Lord had to say and where the Lord was leading him, the answer was for him to leave his family business to go do, because the Lord had something else in mind. Well, that was a terrifying idea because of the potential unrest in the family, but he didn't like his job. Yet there were some, you know, family history, you know, family dynamics. And when he finally did leave the family business, the Lord opened up his world in such a way that today he is loving what he does. And it's in the U.S., not in Africa. So what is it the Lord is asking you to do, or to think about, or to consider? Maybe, you know, we're in the process of elders and deacons. Have you wondered about that question? No, I couldn't be an elder. I couldn't be a deacon. I have all these five reasons, lots of good reasons. Why not? And some of us do have good reasons, so I'm not dismissing that. And some of us know from the Lord we're not supposed to go down certain paths. And not dismissing that at all. Discernment is so important. Maybe you hesitate to question what your spiritual gifts are, because if God gives you a gift, then you'll have to use it. And you just don't know if you want to go down that path. So it might just be better not even to pursue the spiritual gifts, because I don't want to be made a fool of in church or have to do something crazy. Maybe there's a ministry that your heart is tugging you to for whatever reason, and you just can't see how that ministry fits into your current life dynamic with all of your schedules and with the way things are already. So you won't even entertain the conversation with God because you just know that it's just going to make things miserable. What is it that the Lord is inviting you into? Where is he inviting you to go that you're holding back? I will offer you this encouragement from our story today, from Gideon's story, which I saw in my own life. But again, this is not exceptional dramatic material. This is who the Lord is. This is how he operates in our lives every day. And sometimes we have to throw out a lot of fleeces. And sometimes things get hard. And sometimes we get mad. And our anger with the Lord lasts for a while because things are hard. Things are not the way they're supposed to be. But God said to Gideon, and God said to me, and God says to you, I will be with you. You don't have to figure out your life on your own. You don't have to go into these scary places in your own strength. You don't have to have the vision to see beyond. I've got you. I've got your back. And it might be an adventure, and it might take creative twists and turns, but ultimately, for God's glory, for your deliverance, for the good of the church. And I give you my Holy Spirit to be with you all the time, always, every day of your life. Because God says, I will be with you. And it's true. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you and praise you that indeed you are faithful. You indeed are faithful. Now, you definitely are trustworthy, and you've got us, and yet there are times in all of our lives where we are anxious, or we are hesitant, or we are afraid. And so we ask, Lord, will you meet us in those places just like you met Gideon? Will you be patient with us just like you revealed yourself in Scripture as a patient God? Will you be gentle with us like you are with your people? For we are your people. And then, Lord, will you give us the courage to ask the questions and to take the baby steps and to test the waters and to be bold in the capacity that we have in your strength by the power of the Holy Spirit. For your glory and for your church's glory, your church's deliverance, for the good of the church. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. You are welcome in this church and you are welcome in our hearts. Come, Holy Spirit, come. We need you. And we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.